Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Skinfolk Stories by Nalo Hopkinson. Narrated by Bahni Turpin. Riding the Red. Throughout the Caribbean, under different names, you'll find stories about people who aren't what they seem. Skin gives these skin folk their human shape. When the skin comes off, their true selves emerge. They may be owls. They may be vampiric balls of fire. And always, whatever the burden their skins bear, once they remove them, once they get under their own skins, they can fly. It seemed an apt metaphor to use for these stories collectively.
She never listens to me anymore. I've told her and I've told her. Daughter, you have to teach that child the facts of life before it's too late. But no, I am an old woman. And she'll raise her daughter as she sees fit, ma. Thank you very much. So I tried to tell her little girl myself. Listen, dearie. Listen to grandma. You're growing up, hmm? Getting dreamy? Pretty soon now you're going to be right in the red. And if you don't look smart, next stop is Wolfie's house. And Wolfie, doesn't he just love the smell of that blood? Oh, yes. Little girl was beginning to pay attention, too. But of course, her saintly mother bustled in right then, sent her off to do her embroidery, and lit into me for filling the child's head with ghastly old wives' tales. Told me girl is too young yet. There's plenty of time. Daughter's forgotten how it was, she has. All growed up and responsible now. But there's more things to remember than when to do the milking and did you sweep the dust from the corners. Just as well they went home early that time, her and her little one. Leave me be here alone with my cottage in the forest and my memories. That's as it should be. But it's the old wives who best tell those tales, oh yes. It's the old wives who remember. We've been there, and we lived to tell them. And don't I remember being young once and toothsome and drunk on the smell of my own young blood flowing through my veins? And didn't it make me feel all shivery and nice to see Wolfie's nostrils flare as he scented it? I could make Wolfie slaver, I could, and beg to come close, just to feel the heat from me. And oh, the game I made of it, the dance I led him. He caught me, of course. Some say he even tricked me into it. And it may be they're right, but that's not the way this old wife remembers it. Wolfie must have his turn, after all. That's only fair. My turn was the dance, the approach and retreat, the graceful sway of my body past his nostrils, scented with my flesh. The red hood was mine to catch his eye, and my task it was to pluck all those flowers, to gather fragrant bouquets with a delicate hand, an agile turn of a slim wrist, the blood beating at its joint like the heart of a frail bird. There is much plucking to be done in the dance of riding the red. But Wolfie has his own measure to tread too, he does. First, slip past the old mother, so slick. And then, oh then, isn't Wolfie a joy to see? His dance is all hot breath and leaping flank, piercing eyes to see with and strong hands to hold. And the teeth, ah yes. The biting and the tearing and the slipping down into the hot and wet. That measure we danced together, Wolfie and I. And yes, I cried then, down in the dark with my grandma, till the woodman came to save us. But it came all right again, didn't it? That's what my granddaughter has to know. It comes all right again. I grew up, met a nice man. Reminded me a bit of that woodman he did, and so we were married. And wasn't I the model good wife then, just like my daughter is now? And didn't I bustle about and make everything just so, what with the cooking and the cleaning, and the milking and the planting and the birthing, and I don't know what all? And in the few quiet times, the nights before the fire burned down too low to see, I would mend and mend. No time for all that fancy embroidery that my mama taught me. I forgot Wolfie. I forgot that riding the red was more than a thing of soiled rags and squalling newborns and what little comforts you and your man can give each other. Nights when sleep doesn't spirit you away soon as you reach your bed. I meant to tell my little girl, the only one of all those babes who lived, and dearer to me than diamonds. But I taught her embroidery instead, not dancing. And then it was too late. I tried to tell her quick before she set off on her own, so pretty with her little basket. But the young, they never listen, no. They're deaf from the sound of their own new blood rushing in their ears. But it came all right. We got her back safe. We always do. And that's the mercy. It was the fright killed my dear ma'am a few days later. That's what they say, she being so old and all. But mayhap it was just her time. Perhaps her work was done. But now it's me that's done with all that, I am. My goodman's long gone, his back broke by toil, and I have time to just sit by the fire and see it all as one thing, and know that it's right, that it must be so. Ah, but wouldn't it be sweet to ride the red just once more before I'm gone? Just one time when I can look Wolfie in the eye and match him grin for grin and show him that I know what he's good for? For my mama was right about this at least. The trick is, you must always have a needle by you and a bit of thread. Those damned embroidery lessons come in handy, they do. What's torn can be sewn up again, it can, and then we're off on the dance once more. They say it's the woodman saves us, me and my daughter's little girl. But it's Wolfie gives us birth, oh yes. And I haven't been feeling my best nowadays, haven't been too spry. So I'm sure it's time now. My daughter's a hard one, she is. Never quite forgot how it was, stuck in that hot, wet dark, not knowing rescue was coming. But she's a thoughtful one, too. The little one's probably on her way right now with that pretty basket. Don't stop to dawdle, dear. Don't leave the path. But they never hear. And the flowers are so pretty, just begging to be plucked. Well, it's time for one last measure. Yes. One last sweet dance. Listen, is that a knock at the door? Money Tree. Rio Cobre means copper river, perhaps because it used to be customary to throw bright, shiny coppers into the river as an offering to Oshun, the female deity of the waters. Silke was having dreams of deluges. They'd started soon after she got the news about her brother, Morgan. The dreams frightened her. Mile-high tidal waves that swallowed cities. Vast masses of water shifting restlessly over drowned skyscrapers. In one nightmare, she was living in a cottage on a mountaintop. She was cooking a meal for Morgan, barbecuing fat pink prawns on an outdoor grill while she and her brother laughed and talked. Far away on the horizon was the outline of another mountain range, a wide plateau. She heard water running. It irritated her that Morgan had left a tap on. What a way the boy was lazy. She turned to tell him to go and turn it off, and saw the plateau in the distance. Water was spilling over the top of it, billions of gallons rushing over that mountain range miles away. That's what she'd been hearing. Morgan shouted, "The water table, it rising!" Before Silke could stop him, he ran down the hill, yelling that he had to go and get his wallet. She knew that the flood would drown the city below, then rise to engulf her, and there was nothing she could do about it. Morgan would have called the dreams apocalyptic. He would have hauled some tatty paperback about mysticism and the psychic power of dreams off the bookshelf and launched into a speech about how she was tapping into her archetypal consciousness or something. In her mind's eye, Silke could just see his earnest expression as he tried to convince her, the eagerness that could usually make her smile ever since they were children. She made herself a cup of tea and took it to the kitchen table. She shoveled a tablespoonful of sugar from the sugar bowl into her mug. Demerara brown sugar, damp with molasses and moist as mud. The glimmering crystals swirled like chips of gold, then sank slowly to the bottom of the cup. She loved the rich taste, hoarded the demerara sugar for herself. Guests could have the white. In Jamaica, it was the other way around. The costly refined sugar was for guests, and the everyday brown sugar was cheap. Mummy would have been horrified at how expensive demerara sugar was in Toronto. Silke was aware that her mind was wandering, skittering over mundane things to avoid thinking about Morgan. The Jamaican police hadn't found him. It was horrible not knowing whether she should be grieving or not. She stood up and walked over to the kitchen window, leaned out to look at the pear tree just outside. The moist heat of the summer past had been good for the tree. In the crisp fall air, its branches drooped with heavy fruit. The pears looked like the bodies of plump, freckled green women. Through the leaves of the tree, the sun cast pale disks of gold onto the pears. The autumn light was muted, as though everything were underwater. If she stretched a little, Silke could touch one or two of the pears, stroke their smooth skin. Many of them were about to ripen. Soon she'd be able to pluck sustenance from the watery air. The pear tree was the main reason that Silke had persuaded Morgan that they should buy this little old house with the silverfish living in the cracks. Besides, it was what they could afford. What with Morgan only doing casual work at the car parts plant, he was angling for full time, but until then her job as research assistant for the Ministry of State just barely brought in enough to keep them both going. Morgan had been fed up of never having enough money, and he thought he'd found a quick way to make his fortune back home. He wouldn't tell her about it, had wanted to surprise her. He'd flown to Jamaica, where Silke had had one phone call from him. His plans were going well. It looked like his hunch was going to pan out. Then he disappeared. The cold air through the kitchen window was making her eyes water. When they were children, Silke and Morgan used to fly with their parents to Gaspar Grande Island off the coast of Trinidad to spend the summer holidays there. That was before it became a fancy resort. At the time, there were only a few rambling cottages and a small house where the caretaker lived with his old dog. Silke and her brother would dig sea cockroach barnacles out of the rocks for bait, then fish all morning for little yellow grunts, mimicking the fish's croaking sounds as they pulled them up out of the water. They would take their catch for their mother to gut. The rest of the day, the island was theirs to roam. They would climb sweet sap trees for the green-skinned bumpy fruit, sucking out the sweet milky pulp and spitting the black seeds at each other. During those holidays, Silke felt that she could want no other food, need no other air to breathe. She remembered her mother driving from the jetty into the dark water, circling down past the parrotfish and the long-snouted garfish, until Silke could barely make her out, her plump body shimmering greenish in the deep water. She seemed to stay under forever, and it scared Silke and Morgan, but Daddy would simply smile.
"It's by the riverside I first met your mother. She was in the water swimming, like some kind of manatee. Mama Joe woman, mermaid woman, happy in the sea, happy in the river," he laughed. "What a man your daddy must be, eh? To make a fair maid from the river consent to come and live on dry land with him."
The children wouldn't be reassured, though, until she burst to the surface again, not even winded. Their mother had tried to teach them both to swim, but the sight of her sinking into the black water appalled them. Morgan refused to be coaxed in any deeper than the shallows. Silke remembered him shaking his head no, how the sunlight would make diamonds of the water flying from his tight peppercorn curls. For herself, she had loved the feeling of body surfing, but wouldn't put her whole head under the water. She'd stick her face in just far enough to be able to see the grunts flit by. She never learned to dive beneath the surface the way her mother did.
"Just try to go deep enough, sweetheart," Mommy would say,
undulating her arms to show her how to stroke through the water.
"You and Morgan can both do it. You're my children. I'm right here. I won't let anything happen to you."
But Silke hadn't wanted to be swallowed up by that dark wetness. She had another dream that night. In it, she had survived the flood from the previous nightmare. She was swimming on the surface above the drowned lands. Bloated corpses bumped her from time to time. The horror made her skin prickle. She put her face into the water to inspect the damage below her. She could see submerged roads, tiny fish nibbling at dissolving lumps of flesh, a sea anemone already blossoming on a disintegrated carcass that had sunk to the seabed. The sea gave a greenish cast to the rotting flesh of the drowned people. In the rigor of death, a man clutched at a slab of coral the size of a dinner table. The coral glowed reddish gold in the flickering water. The man's face was turned up towards her. His dying gasps for air had contorted it into a ghastly scream. Watery light glistened off his teeth, turning them to gleaming coins. Silke was terrified. Just then, a freak wave rose and slammed her down into the depths, tossing her against the drowned man. The current rearranged his features. It was Morgan. His eyes opened and he reached a beseeching hand out to his sister. She couldn't stop herself. She screamed. She expected the brine to flood her lungs, burning them, filling them like sponges, but it entered her body slowly. Sweet. And sustaining, like a breath of air. In disbelief, she heaved, trying to expel the liquid from her stomach. She woke in terror, blowing hard. She was lying in bed, a few strands of her hair crushed between her face and the pillow. Some of it had worked its way into her mouth. The hair tasted brackish as the sea, as though she'd been crying in her sleep. Silke lay shivering under the icy sheets, trying to get rid of the image of herself drowned, swollen full of salty water. She was afraid that if she hadn't woken up, the sea would have changed her, rotting the flesh of her dream hands and feet into corrupt parodies of flukes, while eels snapped at her melting flesh. Her Mama Joe mother could live in the sea like a mermaid, but she could not. The pears were ripe. Silke climbed the tree with a basket hooked over one shoulder, a long scarf inside it. She wedged the basket into a crook of the tree so that she would have her hands free to pick. Shards of golden sunlight struck her eyes.
She looked down. A light breeze was rippling the grass in waves. She was sailing on a green sea. When they were children, she and Morgan would climb the Julie mango tree in the back of the house and pretend that they were old-time pirates, scaling the mast to spy out ships to plunder. Other little boys in Mona Heights had had cap guns. Morgan had a plastic sword. He used to jab Silky with it until that time when she punched him and broke his nose. Grampy had been so mad at her. As she reminisced, Silky picked a fat golden pear, but with a liquid sound, it collapsed in her hand, rotted from within. Ugh, nasty. She flicked the soggy mush off her fingers and wiped her hand on her jeans. After Mommy and Daddy died, the children's grandfather came from Spanish Town to take care of them. He was the one who had told them the story about Jackson, a man who had lived just outside Spanish Town in the 1600s. People hadn't known it at the time, but Jackson had been a carpenter turned pirate. He was a greedy man. He had drugged the crew with doped rum and scuttled their ship at sea while they were still in it. He had drowned his mates so that he could retire rich with their booty.
Guilt drove Jackson crazy, Grampy told them. The ghosts of the drowned pirates called from their grave in the sea and asked the river spirit for her help. They said she could have their gold if she gave them revenge. River Mama loves shiny things. She agreed. She would come to Jackson at night. As he tossed and turned in his bed, he could hear the river whispering in his ear that he was a murderer and a thief. River Mama told him she would have revenge and she would have his gold. Jackson was afraid, but he was more greedy than scared. He wasn't going to let her have the doubloons. He used his carpenter skills to make a huge table of heavy Jamaican mahogany. Then he nailed every last gold coin onto it, hid it in his cellar. He stopped bathing, stopped talking to his neighbors, stayed in his house all the time.
Then what happened? Silky had whispered, holding tight to Morgan's sleeve for reassurance. He looked just as scared as she.
Jackson didn't even notice the heavy rains that year. It rained so hard that the Rio Cobre River that ran beside his property swelled up big. He was in his cellar admiring his gold when the Rio Cobre broke its banks and gouged a new course for itself, right through his home. The house was demolished. River Mama sent the water for him, Grampy said. The last thing the neighbors saw was a big golden table rising to the surface of the rushing water. It floated for 12 seconds with Jackson clinging to it. Then it sank. If he had let go, they might have been able to save him, but he refused to leave his treasure.
What happened to the table?
Morgan had asked. He was 11 and already had a taste for money. Grampy was looking after his two orphans as best he could, but things were tight.
No one ever fetched a golden table out of the Rio Cobre. They say that at the stroke of noon every day, it rises to the top of the water and it floats for exactly 12 seconds, then sinks again, dragging anything else in the water down with it.
Silky's basket was full. She tied the scarf around the handle and lowered it to the ground, climbing down after it. She lugged it inside the house. Morgan loved pears. She would make preserves from them, stew them in her precious demerara sugar to keep them until he returned. The Jamaican police had sent her Morgan's effects. Some clothes, a letter he hadn't mailed. She had put the letter with the month's stack of bills on the bookshelf. At least the insurance was covering Morgan's half of the mortgage payments. Morgan used to say to her,
"Back home, they tell you that when you come up to Canada, it's going to be easy, not like in Jamaica, that you'll be able to reach out your hand and pull money from the trees. Money will just fall into your lap like fruit. I wonder where my money tree is," he said.
He had explained his plan to her in his unmailed letter. He had gone back to Jamaica to look for the golden table.
"I think I can really find it, Silky. The Rio Cobra has altered its course twice since the pirate Jackson built his home beside it. Once when he drowned with his treasure, and once more when they built the irrigation works in the 1800s. The works have drained off so much water onto the plain that you can actually walk on parts of the riverbed in the dry season. That's when I'm going to go looking for the golden table. I can dig late at night when nobody will see me. I even know the spot where the old people say it is. It's a deep sinkhole that doesn't dry up until the height of the dry season. No one looks for the table, you know. They're afraid. People out here still tell stories about a plantation owner way, way back who tried to have his slaves pull the table out of the water when it rose at noon. 6 men drowned that day, and 12 yokes of oxen dragged under when the table sank to the bottom again.
Suppose it's really there. All that gold.
It's almost dry season now. Just a few more weeks, and maybe I'll be coming home rich. I'll see you soon."
If Silky had known what Morgan had been up to, she would have talked him out of it. When they were children, her mother had made it clear that she was to look out for her younger brother. "You're the eldest one, Silky, and a girl to boot, so you have to have more sense. That boy's so full of mischief, always getting himself in deep water. You have to be ready to pull him out. Your daddy and I won't always be around, you know." Silky had resented the burden placed on her. She loved Morgan, but at the time, she'd been a child too, just like him. Why did she have to take care of him? Isn't that what our parents were for? After their parents were killed in the car crash, Silky sometimes wondered if her mother had known that they wouldn't be around to see their children into adulthood. Like Silky, Mummy used to dream things. And if Mummy had known that, had she also known how to save Morgan? Did she die before she could tell her daughter what to do? Silky had another dream. Morgan was standing beside her on the bank of the Rio Cobre. He put an arm around her shoulders to draw her close and pointed into the murky water.
"It's time," he said. "Look into the water, Silky. No, bend your head like so, quickly. 12 seconds and it gone. See it? Rising towards us through the river water? That big round of pure gold? That tabletop shimmering like the promise of heaven? Getting bigger? Coming closer? 4, 3, 2. Gone again. Sunk back into the depths of the river. You can't take it out, you know? The spirits drag you down. If I jump in, Silky, you will pull me out? I can't swim."
She didn't answer him, just stared down into the roiling water that would melt her flesh and change her if she went into it. Morgan had been staying with a cousin in Spanish Town, Leonie and her husband, Brian. In a phone call, Leonie told Silky that Morgan had started going out late at night, returning while it was still dark. Leonie had surprised him coming in at 4 o'clock one morning. He was laughing softly to himself, and she could smell stale sweat on him, like he'd been doing hard labor. When he saw her, he hid a pouch of some kind behind his back, scowled at her, and went to his room.
She had heard the key turn in the lock. After that, he kept to himself. He took a knapsack with him when he left the house in the evenings. Sometimes they saw him when he brought the knapsack back late at night, bulging with whatever was inside it. He cradled it to his body like a lover. He stayed in his room during the days, but they knew when he was in the house by the reek of sweat that followed him. Morgan had stopped using the shower, muttered that he didn't want the water to wash him away. Then had tried to pass it off as a joke. They had been afraid he was going mad. A few days later, a tropical storm hit Jamaica hard. The Rio Cobre swelled its banks again, and by morning, Leonie's house was flooded knee-deep in water. She and Brian knew they had to leave the house until the storm was over. They had called for Morgan through the bedroom door, but there was no answer. Finally, Brian broke the door down. The room was empty. All they found were his clothes and his knapsack with a few waterlogged splinters of wood inside it. The police told Leonie that Morgan had probably used it to carry marijuana. They assumed it was a dope deal gone bad, and they expected to find his body at any time, shot and dumped somewhere. In Toronto, fall went by and winter settled in, gelid and sullen. Silky stuffed towels into the house's old cracks to keep the wind out. She moped, barely able to drag herself through work every day. Her colleagues tiptoed around her, speaking quietly. She overheard her boss whispering to another manager over the coffee machine, "Brother and drugs." She didn't care. All she could think about was Morgan. Her body felt heavy, earthbound. She started taking long, hot baths in the evenings, soaking in the deep old claw-footed tub in the darkened bathroom. The water and the dark soothed her, sank into her bones. It felt as though she could float away on the water like an otter, buoyed up from the sorrow that was weighing her down. One evening, face bathed in tears, Silky decided to give her body to the water. She let herself sink completely under the surface of the bath. She held her breath for a long time, feeling at peace, listening to the whispering of the water. Then she inhaled. It burned into her lungs, but she fought her body's thrashing and stayed under. Strangely, the pain in her chest soon stopped. It seemed like she stayed submerged for a long time, waiting for death, but nothing happened. She sat up in the bathtub, and warm water drained harmlessly from her mouth and nose. She felt a curious contentment. She got out of the bath and went to bed. For the first time since Morgan's disappearance, sleep felt like a benediction. Silky didn't really notice spring come and go. She had no more dreams of Morgan. She started smiling at work again, even went out for drinks one evening with a couple of the women from the office. She drank only water all night, though, glass after glass, until her friends teased her that she would burst. But she was feeling so dry. It had been hours since her last soak in the tub. She dipped a napkin in her glass and dabbed it on her chest and arms. The first thing she did when she got home was to have a long bath, reveling in the feel of water on her skin. She was amazed when she looked out the kitchen window one Sunday afternoon and saw that the pear tree was in full leaf. Tender, bright green leaves dancing like tiny fish in the balmy air currents. It was late May, 9 months since Morgan had disappeared. In that time, Silky had birthed herself again. After her failed attempt at suicide, the odd sense of peace had stayed with her. She still grieved for her brother, but no longer felt as though she would die from the pain. In fact, she felt almost invulnerable, as though she could swim through air or breathe in water. Silky looked at herself in her bedroom mirror that Sunday afternoon, wondering if the change in her was apparent on her face. Over the winter, she'd become as portly as her mother had been. She actually found the plump curves of her new full pear shape pleasing. But she was feeling the effects of 9 months of inactivity. "It's spring, Morgan," Silky said to the air. "Time to get into shape." No time like the present. She grabbed workout gear and a bathing suit and walked over to the YMCA. She tried the weight room, but after a few painful contortions on the Nautilus machines, she decided to go to the pool instead. It had been years, but she was sure that she'd remember her mother's lessons. It was 5 minutes to midday. The noon public swim was just about to start. Silky wrinkled her nose at the smell of chlorine. The space rang with the laughter of children, sleek and plump as seals as they splashed in the water or raced around the pool deck. She went to the tree lanes roped off for doing laps. An old woman moved with slow grace through the water, blowing like a walrus when she came to the turns. Feeling a little nervous, Silky eased herself in. She did the breaststroke so that she could keep her head out of the water. After a few laps, she settled into the rhythm of lane swimming. She no longer heard the noise of the children playing. She kept swimming, always a few feet behind the old woman, who seemed tireless. As usual, her thoughts turned to her lost brother. Silky believed that Morgan had found the golden table. She believed that by night, he pried the doubloons out of the rotten wood and brought them back bit by bit to Leone's house. But the money was not his to take. River Mama had claimed it. Grampy used to say, "Want all, lose all." Silky believed that because Morgan stole that treasure, River Mama had stolen away his wits, made him afraid of the water. And when he still wouldn't return the gold, she came to get it herself and took him into the water as punishment, the way she had done with the pirate Jackson before him. The summer sun shot rays of light through the windows to the pool deck. The light refracted in the blue water, flickering so that Silky couldn't see below the surface of the pool. With one hand, she shaded her eyes from the glare. It was noon, the time the golden table rises up from the bed of the Rio Cobre. Ahead of Silky, the old woman stopped, treading water until Silky drew level with her. The woman's skin was brown, and her eyes were like those of Silky's mother. The old woman smiled at her.
"He always getting into deep water," she said. "Stubborn, greedy boy. But he's my son from your Mama Joe mother, so I'll let you pull him out. You have to dive, though. You're changed enough to do it now. But hurry, daughter's daughter. Only 6 seconds left."
The glare brightened until Silky could no longer see River Mama. The light seemed to be coming from beneath her now. She felt her heart slamming in her chest, beating the seconds away. The water was rushing and swirling around her. The river had found her. Looking down into it, Silky saw a great golden disc, glowing as it rose to the surface. She was dimly aware of squeals of alarm all around her. People clambering out of the pool, the lifeguard shouting, "Get out! Everybody out of the water!" She could see Morgan clinging stubbornly to the golden table, refusing to relinquish all that gold. If she give herself to the water, would she become a Mama Joe, like her mother? No time for doubt. Silky dove, inhaling as she went. The Rio Cobre waters bubbled cool and sweet as air into her lungs. She was truly her mother's daughter. Morgan was closer now. She could see his upturned face, but couldn't read his expression. Would she be able to pluck Morgan from the table, like fruit from a tree? Or would his need suck them both down to drown and rot in the green, greedy depths? Breathing in the strength of the river, she swam down with strong strokes to get her brother. Something to hitch meat to. The title of this story comes from a response a student once wrote on a test, if one can believe any of the endless email spam one gets. I wish I knew who that student was so that I could thank the person. It really is one of the most inspired definitions I've ever read. Artho picked up a bone lying in the street. No reason, just one of those irrational things you do when your brain is busy with something else, like whether you remembered to buy avocados or not. The alligator tail chain of a daycare snaked past him, each toddler hanging on dutifully to one of the knots in the rope by which they were being led. One of the young, gum-popping nannies said, "So then, little Zuki draws herself up real tall and she says, 'No, silly. The purpose of the skeleton is something to hitch meat to.'" Really? I swear I nearly died laughing. She sounded so serious. The woman eyed him as she walked past, smiled a little, glanced down. She played with her long hair and stage whispered to her coworker, "God, Latino men are just so hot, don't you think?" They giggled and moved on, trailing children. The gears of Artho's brain kicked back into real time. He was standing at the southwest corner of King and Bay, holding a chicken thigh bone. Fleshless and parched, it felt dusty between his fingers. He dropped it and wiped his hand off on his jeans. Latino? What the hell? Streetcar coming. Artho got on, elbowing himself some rush hour standing room between an old man with a bound live chicken that lay gasping in his market basket and three loud, hormonal young women, all politics and piercings. Artho reached for a steady strap. Traffic was gridlocked. He stared blankly out the window as the streetcar inched its way past a woman struggling with two huge dogs on leashes. Bergers des Pyrenees, they were. Giant, woolly animals, bred for rescuing skiers trapped under alpine avalanches. They were so furry that Artho could barely make out their legs. They lumbered along in a smooth, four-on-the-floor gait. The dog's handler tugged futilely at their leashes, barely able to keep up. The beasts could probably cover miles in effortless minutes, snowshoeing on their woolly feet. Artho fancied that they would move even faster, smoother, if you changed them to have six legs, or eight. They would glide along like enormous tarantulas. Artho looked at their handler's legs and had the oddest feeling, like when an old film skips a frame, and for an instant you can see the whole punched edges of the film strip, black and chitinous, on the screen. And then it jerks back into place. But now you're looking at a different scene than you were before. It was like that, Artho looking at this woman walking on ordinary woman legs. Then reality skipped frames, and he was seeing instead a being whose natural four-legged stance had been twisted and warped so that all it could manage was this ungainly, two-legged jerking from foot to foot, made into something it wasn't. Alarmed, Artho blinked. He made himself relax. Tired. Too many hours at work in front of a computer screen, staring at all that skin. He
He leaned his head against the streetcar window and dozed, thinking hungrily of the stewed chicken and rice he would have for dinner with avocado. His dad always called them alligator pears on the side. He could see the fleshy avocado in his mind's eye, slit free of its bumpy rind, pegged and sitting on a plate, beads of salt melting on the sweating, creamy skin. He imagined biting into a slice, his teeth meeting in its spineless center. His mouth watered. It wasn't until he reached his stop that he realized he really had forgotten to buy the damned avocados. He found some tired, wrinkly ones in the corner store near his apartment. The man behind the counter who served Artho at least twice a week when he came in for cigarettes or munchies grumbled at the $50 bill that Artho gave him and made a big show over holding it up to the light to see if it was counterfeit. Artho had seen the same man cheerfully make change from bills that large for old women or guys in suits. He handed Artho a couple of 20s and some coins, scowling. Artho held each 20 up to the light before putting it into his pocket. "Thank you," he said sweetly to the guy, who glared. Artho took his avocados and went home. When he sliced into them, one of them was hard and black inside. He threw it out. "So," Artho's brother said, "I'm out with the guys the other night and..." "Huh? What did you say?" Artho asked. Something was obscuring Aziman's voice on the phone, making rubbing and clicking sounds over and around his speech. "What's that noise?" Artho asked the receiver. "Like dice rolling together or something." "One dice, two die. Or is it the other way around? Anyway, so I'm..." "What are you eating? I can't make out what you're saying." "Hold on." Silence. Then Aziman came on again. "This any better?" "Yeah, what was that?" "This hard candy the kids brought home. Got me hooked on it. These little round white thingies, you know? I had a mouthful of them." "Did you spit them out?" "Well, not round exactly. Kinda egg-shaped, but squarer than that. Is squarer a word?" "Did you spit them out?" Artho was just being pissy, and he knew it. He could tell that Aziman had gotten rid of the candies somehow. His voice was coming through clearly now. "Yeah, Artho. Can I tell my story now?" "Where'd you spit them?" "What's up with you today?" "Down the kitchen sink." And Aziman started in with his story again, but Artho was distracted, thinking on the tiny white candies disappearing into the drain, perhaps washed down with water. "So this man walks up to us, a kid really, you know, smart-ass, yuppie, corn-fed kid with naturally blonde hair and a polo shirt on, probably an MBA, and he says to me, 'Sup, man?' Only he says it, 'Mon.' I mean, I guess he's decided I'm from Jamaica or something, you know?" "Yeah," said Artho. "I know." "He gives me this weird handshake, grabs my thumb, and then makes a fist. And I'm supposed to touch my fist to his, I think. I don't know if I did it right, but he says, 'What's up again?' And I realize I didn't answer him, so I just say, 'Nothing much,' which I guess isn't the lingo, right? But I don't know what I'm supposed to say. I mean, you and me, we're freaking North Toronto niggers, right? And this white guy's got Toronto suburbs written all over him, too. Probably never been any farther than Buffalo. So what's he trying to pull with that fake ghetto street shit anyway, you know?" And he leans in close, kind of chummy-like, and whispers, "Think you could sell me some shit, man?" And I'm thinking, like the kind you're trying to sell me on right now? I mean,
He's asking me for dope or something.
Artho laughed. Yeah. Happens to me, too. It's always the same lame-ass question. Never changes. I just point out the meanest-looking, blackest motherfucker in the joint and say, not me, man, but I bet that guy'll be able to help you out. Shit, I'll try that next time. Though, I guess it isn't fair, you know, my doing that. It's like I'm picking on guys just because they're blacker than me. Heh, I guess. If you want to look at things that way. You going to Mom's for Easter? Is Aunt Dee going to be there? But Aziman's only reply was a rustling, shucking type of noise. Then,
shit!
What? I stuck my hand into the bag for more candy, you know? Just figured out what these things are. What?
Skulls.
Little sugar skulls, for Christ's sake.
Dead people bits. That's what the candy was. It was all in the way you looked at it.
No, said Artho. It'll be just like last year. I'm not going to Mom's for Easter.
A few days later, it happened again.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.